BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book of Nahum. The prophet Nahum. Okay, Nahum. All right. We're going to, this is message P239. It is entitled, God Never Changes. Sorry, changes. I'm like looking at Nahum and I'm reading and speaking at the same time. God never changes. We're going to look at this in this Erev Shabbat message here in New York. And we're going to look at the attributes of God about Him never changing. So we're going to look at this because it has great implications of what's going on. Nahum chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. This part is entitled, He Knows How to Be Angry. He knows how to be angry. Nahum chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. Yehovah is a jealous and vengeful God. Yehovah avenges. He knows how to be angry. Yehovah takes vengeance on His foes and stores up wrath for His enemies. Yehovah is slow to anger, but great in power, and He does not leave the guilty unpunished. Yehovah's path is in the whirlwind and storm, and the clouds are the dust of His feet. Amen. Wow, that is one powerful prophecy. Not too many times do you see this attribute of Elohim, of Yehovah, that in verse 2, as we look closer to that, He is a vengeful God. In verse 3, it says He's slow to anger, but when He gets angry, you don't want to be in His path. When He's angry, you don't want to be in His path because He's jealous, okay? He avenges. Now, it also says there, if we look closer at verse 2 again, Yehovah is jealous and a vengeful God. Yehovah avenges. He knows how to be angry. Yehovah takes vengeance on His foes and stores up wrath for His enemies. So let's take that sentence apart before we go to the other parts of slow to anger. Okay? So He's jealous. Now what would make Him jealous? Well, when you worship other gods, even yourself being God, when you say you don't want to follow His commandments. Okay, now that we've gone through, like, you know, in this series, we've gone through like 4 or 5 years worth of parash readings. We've gone deep into each chapter of the Torah. And now you're required and you're really responsible at this point to be understanding of the word of Torah. Because here at Beth Goyim, we preach Yeshua crucified and risen from the dead, Messiah crucified and risen from the dead, and that the law is still good and the law is still needed to this day. Now, here also in verse 2, it's really a fascinating sort of worrisome to some people. He knows how to be angry. He knows how to be angry. Now, around the globe, we're really challenging His patience with a lot of fornication, this homosexuality stuff, and all this other things. So the Lord knows how to be angry. He's slow to anger, as it says in verse 3, but He knows, just because somebody's slow to anger doesn't mean that they're not going to get angry. And then when He blows His top, You know, you don't want to be anywhere around it. Sort of like when Mount St. Helens exploded in the 80s here in America and on the West Coast. You know, it wiped out a lot of area, you know, the trees, all the trees. You know, it's amazing looking at the pictures, okay? And as we're seeing many earthquakes around the globe, tremendous amount of earthquakes. I know at least three volcanoes that are erupting around the globe already and sending so much ash around the globe. So here the Lord is, he's giving us signs because he says he's slow to anger. Look at verse 3 again. Yehovah is slow to anger, but great in power, and he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Yehovah's path is in the whirlwind and the storm, and the clouds are the dust of his feet. Something you might want to think about. He does not leave the guilty unpunished. So if you say, if you're one of those people that says we don't need the law anymore, don't worry, he's slow to anger. But he will not leave you unpunished, whether it's in this life or the next. He's not going to leave you unpunished. Now, these two verses really put some great trepidation in your heart, because in the book of Revelation we have seven seals, seven shofars, seven bowls. And you ask yourself, why is there seven, seven, and seven? Why isn't it just one seal? Because between each seal, there's a pause to see if people are going to repent. But most people are not repenting. There was a lawsuit in Israel this week. A Jew sued God for oppression. A Jew sued the maker of all creation because he felt oppressed by God. And they had a trial. And they said that God didn't show up. Or they said, well, he might have showed up because he's omnipresent, but we didn't see him, so he took the Fifth Amendment. So he didn't speak. Okay, but just for the arrogance, for somebody to bring a lawsuit against God Almighty for being oppressive, that's what people think about his law. So God is showing us in a lot of earthquakes around the globe, a lot of volcanoes erupting, and things ready to really escalate into some real hard times. We need to understand that God is slow to anger, but he never changes. He never changes. Let's go over to the book of Malachi now. Let's go to another prophet. We're going to be now looking at Yehovah never changes. We're going to look at Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1 through 7. We're going to look at the key verse first, which is verse 6. Malachi. So it's right near Nahum, Malachi. Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. This part is called, "Then I will approach for judgment." Verse 6, Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. "But because I, Yehovah, do not change, you sons of Yaakov will not be destroyed." Amen? He won't destroy us in total, but he says, "I do not change." Now, you need to look at Scripture as a whole, from Genesis through to the book of Revelation. When you look at God's pattern, you know, in the Beit HaMikdash or the Mishkan in the desert, blue, purple, scarlet, you know, he made a way that everything had to be made. He has holy days, as we see in Leviticus 23. We have the three holy days in the spring, and then we have one in the summer, and then three in the fall. There's a pattern that he does. There's also a pattern that he follows. And the key here is when he says, I do not change. We're heading into a time that Yeshua spoke about, Matthew 24, that we truly need to understand what's about to happen, because Yehovah says, I do not change. So when you read into the book of Samuel, 1 and 2 Samuel, Chronicles, Kings and Chronicles, Samuel, Kings and Chronicles, you look at a pattern of what happens in the world. You look at a pattern at what happens to the chosen people. You look at a pattern, what happens with chastisement. You look at a pattern at what happens with blessing. This is why in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, let's read that again. But because I, Yehovah, do not change, you sons of Yaakov will not be destroyed. Okay? People say that, God is done with his people. He says, you're not going to be destroyed. You're going to be chastised, and many of you are going to die, but you won't be totally destroyed. But really, for this particular message, P239, God never changes, what we're looking at is that phrase. Yehovah says, I do not change. He's slow to anger. That's why we started with Nahum. He's slow to anger, but when he does finally get angry, when he finally does blow his top, when he does, you don't want to be anywhere around because he's going to make you wish you were dead. Okay? So now let's read Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. And this part is called, Then I Will Approach for Judgment. Malachi 3, verse 1 through 7. Look, I am sending my messenger to clear the way before me. And the Elohim, whom you seek, will suddenly come to his temple. Yes, the messenger of the covenant, in whom you take such delight. Look, here he comes, says Jehovah Sabaoth. But who can endure the day when he comes? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like refiner's fire, like soap maker's lye. He will sit testing and purifying the silver. He will purify the sons of Levi, refining them like gold and silver, so that they can bring offerings to Jehovah uprightly. Then the offering of Yehuda and Jerusalem will be pleasing to Jehovah as it was in the days of old, in the years gone by. Then I will approach you for judgment, and I will be quick to witness against sorcerers, adulterers, and perjurers, against those who take advantage of wage earners, widows and orphans, against those who rob the foreigner of his rights, and don't fear me, says Jehovah Sabaoth. Because I, Jehovah, do not change, you sons of Yaakov will not be destroyed. Since the days of your forefathers, you have turned from my laws and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says Jehovah Sabaoth. But you ask in respect to what are we supposed to return? Wow. Amen. That's another very powerful passage. What arrogance the people had in verse 7. But let's take this apart. We're going to take it apart piece by piece. In verse 1, let's go back to verse 1. Look, I'm sending my messenger to clear the way before me, and the Lord, Elohim, whom you seek, will suddenly come to his temple. Yes, the messenger of the covenant, in whom you take such delight. Look, here he comes, says Jehovah Sabaoth. Amen? Before the Lord does something really big where something's going to change and never go back to the way it was, he always sends a messenger. He raises up leaders. He raises up people that will proclaim that God is sovereign. He will raise up people that will say, go back to the ancient past. He will raise up people that will proclaim Torah. He will raise up bold men to be strong in the word of God, like Pincus or Yochanan the Immerser. Okay? So he's sending a messenger of the covenant, messengers of his word. Now, it was very fascinating the other day. We had here the day of prayer, and they said they had 47,000 places that were in unison with this. America should have changed right then. If you had 47,000 people praying, but see, they don't like the covenant. They like the blessings, but they don't want to do any work that is required. So here, the Lord is sending real messengers to bring forth the truth, bring forth strength of the word, so that you'll know the truth, because the truth is going to set you free. Not just that Yeshua is Messiah. Satan knows that Yeshua is Messiah. He doesn't want to follow Yeshua. Look at verse 2. But who can endure the day when he comes? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire, like a soap maker's lye. Amen? Okay, first, there's four words that we're going to focus in verse 2. Endure, refiner's fire, soap maker's, well, it's a phrase, soap maker's lye. So basically three words, okay? Endure, refiner's fire, and soap maker's lye. Three sections of this sentence. First, why does he say endure? Because he's slow to anger. He's slow to anger, but when he is angry, he chastises in a very severe way. Because why? We didn't want to hear it before. And the only way that a lot of people return to God is when everything is taken away. When you're being a slave, to ISIS, or you're being captured, and then you're praying to God, oh God, heal me, make them stop. That's when you talk to him. But God is saying, who can endure this day when I come? When I'm coming, I'm not coming back as a lamb. I'm coming back as a lion, and I'm not going to be happy. And he's not going to be happy because why? We spit in his face. Around the globe, we spit in his face. Today, in London, for the very first time, a Muslim is the mayor of London. A Muslim. These animals have taken over right by the Queen's house. They're not going to say she's divine. What are you people doing? But God said in Deuteronomy 28, verse 49 and 50, you don't want to follow me? I'll send you some problems. They want Sharia law right there in London. And you just gave it to them. Because why? Because you're not going to be able to endure what's coming. Because he's saying here in the next part, refiner's fire. Refiner's fire is something where you're going to turn up the heat. You're going to turn up the heat because why? The refiner's fire is to take out the impurities. 47,000 people should be able to change the world. Even if there was one person at each one of those places, 47,000 people for the day of prayer. But Proverbs 28:9 says what? If a person doesn't follow Torah, the Lord's not listening to your prayer. So he's turning up the heat. He's exploding volcanoes. In the Antarctic, there is a volcano erupting. What's it going to do with the water? What's it going to do with all the ice? Volcanoes tend to put out a lot of heat. The pictures are amazing. I mean, how much smoke and heat is coming out of it. I mean, you see the satellite picture, you see this glowing red dot in the middle of it. It's like, wow, that's not good. But the Lord is turning up the heat. He's turning up the waters. He's turning up the rain. He's turning up the fire to get your impurities out before he has to really come and make you endure the suffering. Then it says a soap maker's lye. Why the soap maker's lye? It's a real powerful cleaning agent. I'm gonna make you endure. It's going to be really difficult to endure. Look at the Holocaust, really difficult to endure. Look at the two missionaries that were beaten to death in Jamaica. Beaten to death in Jamaica this week. In China, they killed a Christian. They destroyed the building, and the building fell on the woman that was trying to protect it. They don't care. Now he's turning up the heat on the bodies, refining fire. Now he's going to put this soap maker's lye. He's going to get out the rest of the impurities. And that soap maker's lye is real powerful, real painful. You get it on your skin. Ow! Burning! Why? Because he doesn't want to kill you. He doesn't want to kill you. He wants to make you better. He's doing everything to talk to us. He's doing everything to talk to us. Try to get our attention. Look at verse 3. He will sit, testing and purifying the silver. He will purify the sons of Levi, refining them like gold and silver, so that they can bring offerings to Yehovah uprightly. Amen? He's going to purify you because he wants his offerings. He wants people to come to him. He wants people to enjoy doing these things. But he's going to test you. And that's what he's doing right now. Before he comes, in the day that we have to endure, as another prophet talks about in Yoel 2, who can endure the day when he's coming? Testing. He's going to test each one of our hearts. The more he's going to test us, the way he's going to test us, he's going to take things away. He's going to take your money away. He's going to take your power away. He's going to take your security away. He's raising up this black cloud of Muslims all around the world. That's why their flag is black. You know, the American flag, red, white, and blue. What does each color stand for? Red is for the blood that was spilled for those who fought for freedom. White is for the purity that we wanted to have here. And blue is for the sky. Okay? So here he's testing. He's testing our hearts. Where are you going to stand? Are you going to go for Chick-fil-A? And you're going to stand with those who stand for the word of God? Are you going to choose? Who are you going to choose? You're going to choose Barabbas? Or are you going to choose Yeshua? The people chose Barabbas. They wanted the evil murderer instead of the word of God. What are you choosing? In the Philippines, they're choosing a transvestite, not a transvestite, a transgender in your elections. What are you doing? Don't worry. God's testing you to see what you're going to do. You know, when California falls into the ocean, they said the San Andreas Fault is ready to explode. It's going to send a pretty big tsunami the other way. Purifying like silver. Why does he say purifying like silver there in verse 3? Why does he say purifying like silver? Silver you have to turn up at least 7 times hotter than gold to purify it. So imagine the heat turning up this 7 times hot. Oh, there's 7 seals. Who can endure the day of his coming? He wants to purify the sons of Levi. We're all supposed to be a nation of priests. We're supposed to be a nation of priests. Why is he refining them? So that you can bring offerings to Yehovah uprightly. What does uprightly mean? That means those who follow the commandments. He's tired of all this icky stuff that we've been giving him. 47,000 people that don't follow the Sabbath. 47,000 people that don't keep the holy days. 47,000 people that don't keep the kosher laws. 47,000 people that don't circumcise their children. Is this what God wants? People praying in Lutheran churches where they allow this abomination, transgenders, transsexuals, any disgusting thing, and it's okay. God says, I'm going to bring you like refiner's fire. But he never changes. He's slow to anger, but he never changes. Verse 5 and 6. Then I will approach you for judgment, and I will be quick to witness against sorcerers, adulterers, perjurers, against those who take advantage of wage earners, widows and orphans, against those who rob the foreigner of his rights, and don't fear me, says Jehovah Sivaot. But because I, Jehovah, do not change, the sons of Yaakov will not be destroyed. He doesn't say the Gentiles won't be destroyed. He says the sons of Yaakov won't be destroyed. He's going to witness against sorcerers. Well, what is a sorcerer? Somebody who says that we should worship on Sunday is a sorcerer because you're going to worship another god. Somebody who says we need to do Talmud, that is another god. He's going to witness against perjurers, people that lie, people that lie. We have those here in this congregation. I had a student that constantly lied. The student's now gone. Constantly lied. So many lies. Where does he learn that from? It's from his parents. Those type of people are not going, God's going to witness, he's going to approach for judgment. If you're somebody who likes lashon hara, gossip, speaking against your leaders or your congregation, he's going to witness against you. People that don't fear the Lord, people that don't fear the Lord. Who doesn't fear the Lord? Well, we don't need the Old Testament anymore. Well, why should I fear God then? If there's no judgment, why should I fear? I could do whatever I want. I can look at pornography. I can have sex with 35 women at the same time. What should I fear if I don't know what's going to happen to me? But Jehovah says in verse 6, this is a key verse. But because I, Yehovah, do not change, you sons of Yaakov will not be destroyed. If he destroyed the whole world in a flood, because he said, in their heart, they're continual evil. Is that not the world today? Haven't we chosen in many of our countries to follow Barabbas instead of Yeshua? Pilate comes out and he says, who do you want, Barabbas or Yeshua, the Word, the Messiah? But here, the people were egged on to say, we want Barabbas. We want this murderer. We want to follow. We want the murderer to be set free, but we don't want to hear about the Word. We want that Word dead because we don't like hearing the Word anymore. We don't want to hear the Word. Well, that guy, that rabbi's mean. He calls them gay, and he says they're going to hell. I don't say you're going to hell. God says you're going to hell. I can't put you in hell, but my Father can. He's the one who's going to approach for judgment. But if we allow that evil to live in our spaces and we don't do them, we don't remove them, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 5, then we're going to be held accountable. And he's going to refine us. He's going to, you know, push us. He's going to take things away. And all you need to do is study the Holocaust to what happens. Yehovah does not change. Study 1st and 2nd Samuel, Kings and Chronicles. You see, he does not change. And if he did, then he's not a God I want to follow. I like a God that I can count on. One that is steady. One that I can trust, that never changes. That is the God of Abraham, Avinu, our father. Verse 7. Since the days of your forefathers, you have turned from my laws and have not kept them. Return to me, now we'll return to you, says Yehovah Sivaot. But you ask, in respect to what are we supposed to return? What were you thinking? He comes and he says, yeah, come on, guys. Return to me and I'll forgive you, you know? Me, I'd zap you dead. I'd cut your legs off, cut your toes off, you know, one toe at a time, you know. So sometimes, you know, that's some of the old me that comes out. Some of the people in the congregation, oh, I want to cut your ear off, cut your nose off, one piece at a time, you know. But here, verse 7, return to me. Return and I'll forgive you. And then we arrogantly, and that's what's going on in the world today. We arrogantly, in respect to what are we supposed to return? I'm going to return to that keeping kosher. I'm going to return to all day in synagogue. Oh, God, no. I have to stay with one woman for the rest of my life? That's terrible. Can't do that. I like to have sex with more than one woman a week. Here in the colleges this week, they were having polygamy week. Yes, through all the colleges in America and around the globe, they were having this thing, free sex. Don't be monogamous. That's stupid. That's what they're teaching our kids in college. God says, return to me. And the kids are going, return to what? That's so stupid. You guys really think there's a God in heaven? Yeah, idiot, we're on a ball and we're not falling off. Brain surgeon. You know, we evolved from apes. Rocket scientist. Show me one half man, half ape, and I'll believe you. Look at verse 7. It's such an arrogant verse. Since the days of your fathers, you have turned from my laws and have not kept them. Return to me and I will return to you, says Yehovah Sivaot. But you ask, in respect to what are we supposed to return? He says, I'll forgive you. I'll forgive you. But no, we don't want to return to that. All right, that's cool. I'll send ISIS. Another news story this week. But there are those, even Christians, that are amazing. In Iraq this week, no, Iran, there's one Navy SEAL that fought off 400 ISIS fighters. 400. One versus 400. Till finally a sniper from ISIS got him. but he fended off 400. God says, 5 of you will chase 100. 100 of you will chase 10,000. If we return to God, 100 of us will chase 10,000. What are we supposed to return to? You want me to return to that old law? But that's done. That was nailed to the cross. That was nailed to the cross. God never changes. Turn to Numbers chapter 23. Numbers chapter 23. Learning anything? Numbers 23. Bamidbar 23. This is just a portion of tomorrow. Numbers 23, verse 18 through 20. Oh, there's a lot in tomorrow's message. Numbers 23, verse 18 through 20. If the Gentile knew this, then why don't we know this now? Should we don't know this now? Numbers, Bamidbar 23, verse 18 through 20. Then Balaam made this pronouncement. His pronouncement. Get up, Balak, and listen. Turn your ears to me, son of Zippor. Elohim is not a human who lies or a mortal who changes his mind. When he says something, he will do it. When he makes a promise, he will fulfill it. Look, I am ordered to bless. When he blesses, I can't reverse it. Amen? Verse 19 is our key. Here, Balaam is a Gentile who knew Yehovah. He called him by name. And he says in verse 19, Elohim is not like a human that changes his mind. When God said, don't eat the pig, it doesn't change. You know, it's a very simple thing for people to understand. When God said, keep the Sabbath holy, he's not going to change it when he went to the cross with his son. Because then he would change his mind. And God doesn't change his mind. When he says something, he's slow to anger. Slow to anger doesn't mean he does not get angry. Like, he's not this mellow old dude now. You know, like, God's really like an old dude and he's like mellow. That's what like the Christians and a lot of Messianics try to tell me. It's like, no, he's not mellow. He's slow to anger. He's slow to anger. When he makes a promise, he made a promise, seven seals, seven shofars, seven bowls. And the fourth seal, what happens? 25% of the world is dead. Nobody in the world will be exempt from that. When he made the promise to bless, that if you follow his ways, then you will have children. You will have prosperity. You will be raised up. He promises that, and he will fulfill it. If you keep his ways, and we had a great story this week from one of the congregant members. This wonderful lady started a new job, and there was a homosexual at the job. And she was talking to the homosexual, and she told him he's going to hell, you know. Being bold for the word, you know, she didn't start the conversation, but the homo did. And the boss calls her and says, you can't talk like that in here. She said, I didn't start the conversation, but, you know, anyway. And so the boss, like, really chastised her. So she's, like, praying to God. She's praying to God. Next day, she comes into work, and all of a sudden the police come in. And the police take away the homo because the homo was stealing from the business. The boss says to the woman who proclaimed God, he goes, I'm sorry for saying anything to you. God protects his own. When you stand strong for him, trust in him. In the world that we're living in, trust in him and trust in his ways. And he will never leave you or forsake you. You might have to change some things. It might not be exactly what you want, but if you trust in him, then everything, you'll have shalom. If you know he's in charge, because he, as Balaam said there, he's not a human who lies. God said, you do these things in Devarim 28, verse 1 through 14. If you do them, I'll bless you. You might have to move. You might have to change because God might be done with that land. You might be breaking it apart. You might be destroying it because it's got too much sin now. But just go with God and have shalom. And then things will be blessed. Turn to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 15. 1 Samuel 15. 1 Samuel 15. We're going to look at verse 29. 29 and 30. 1 Samuel 15, verse 29 and 30, as you're turning, I'll give you a little background to this so we don't have to read the whole thing. This is when Saul was king and he wasn't really serving well. And the prophet came to him and said, God's tearing the kingdom from you. And he tears off his tzitzit from his garment. He said, God is tearing the kingdom from you. 1 Samuel 15, verse 29 and 30. 1 Samuel 15, verse 29 and 30. 1 Samuel 15, Shmuel Aleph. 1 Samuel 15, verse 29 and 30. Moreover, the Eternal One of Israel will not lie or change his mind, because he isn't a mere human being subject to changing his mind. Then Shaul said, I have sinned, but in spite of that, please show me respect now before the leaders of my people and before Yisrael by coming back with me so I can worship Yehovah your Elohim. Amen? The guy didn't get it. Well, I'm still rich. I don't really care what God thinks. In the beginning, in verse 26, it talks about he tears the kingdom. The prophet's telling me he's tearing the kingdom from him. I don't care. You know, show me some respect, you know, in front of the people. You know, I don't really care what you think. You know, I don't believe you. What he's saying is, I don't believe you. I don't believe you that God is tearing it. I'm going to do what I want. Yeah, he says in verse 30, I've sinned. Saul said, I sinned. But I'm king. Nobody can touch me. I'm a billionaire. Nobody can touch me. I can do whatever I want. I can say whatever I want. Even if it's not true, because it doesn't matter, because you want Barabbas. You want Barabbas. You want the murderer. You want the evil one. You didn't want the word. You wanted the evil one. The people said, give us Barabbas. Give us the one who murdered. You want that on your side? This is what you choose. The people didn't want to hear, go back to Torah. But God doesn't change. The Eternal One of Israel does not lie or change. Does not lie or change. So we should be preparing our hearts, because God does not change. If you read 1 and 2 Samuel, Kings and Chronicles, you see what happens. We're paralleling that. Read the book of Isaiah, chapter 1 through 5. We'll be doing chapter 1 tomorrow. Read the first chapter and go, whoa! Oh my, I'll do my best Indian impression. Oh the goodness, I am not knowing what is going to go on. Yes, you do. Oh the goodness. I will not be going to my 7-Eleven no more. There's a Muslim as a mayor of London. They took over London and they didn't have to fire a shot. The last time they had the Moors had to cross. But here, let them in. Yeah, sure, let them all in, yeah. Sharia law, yeah. But we're going to have our beer. No. I hope you English don't want your tea anymore. Hope the queen is getting her palace ready to be taken over, because they're right in your backyard. Why? Because you kicked God out. Here, Shaul said, I've sinned, but in spite of that, come with me and worship in front of everybody. He's like, no, I'm not doing that. I don't care what you are, the king. No. But here, God doesn't change. I sinned, so what? Let's put on a show. We've sinned, so what? We're gonna party like it's 1999. Oh, I guess he's dead now too. AIDS, overdose, all the money. I guess he's realizing now there really is a hell. He was a Jehovah's Witness. Then he became a Seventh-day Adventist. Or when the other way around. No, he was a seventh day, became a JW. I guess. Titus chapter 1, please. Titus chapter 1. Let's see if this following of God does not change goes on through to the Brit Hadashah. Titus chapter 1. Verse 1 and 2. Titus, Tito, woohoo. Titus chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, God does not lie. From Shaul, God's slave and an emissary of Yeshua the Messiah, sent to promote among God's chosen people the trust and knowledge of truth which lead to godliness and which are based on the certain hope of the eternal life, God who does not lie, promised that life before the beginning of time. Amen? God does not lie. So when God said, keep the Sabbath holy, he doesn't change it. So anybody who's reading the Brit Hadashah and Ephesians, Colossians, and whatever other writing of Paul, you think he's changing the Sabbath and it doesn't matter what day you worship, then God would be a liar. And if God is a liar, then he has to apologize to everybody he drowned in the flood. Because when Adam bit the fruit, all knowledge of good and evil came into him. Then he gave us Torah so that people can't say, well, I don't know what's in my heart, you know. Well, here, it's written down for you now. Because people say, I can't trust my heart. Well, here it's in parchment form. It's scroll form. It's written by his own daggone hand. Keep the Sabbath holy. God who does not lie. God says, do not eat pork. Don't eat these certain animals. Eat these animals. But Peter looked at the vision. No, God does not lie. God does not change. Then he'd have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. If you can eat anything you want now, then you can be a homosexual now. You can't have it both ways. God does not lie. Verse 2, in which are based a certain hope of eternal life. God, who does not lie, promised that life before the beginning of time. So let's take this the whole line. Didn't we read in Malachi that he's going to witness against perjurers, adulterers, sorcerers? What is a sorcerer? Somebody who tells you that you can worship this, you can worship an idol. You can do all these different things. But God said, I don't change. So here in Titus, in verse 2, God does not lie. He's not going to change either. He's not going to lie. He said, keep my Sabbath holy. Well, how do I keep the Sabbath holy? Well, don't do any work. Half the church spends 2 hours or even Messianic congregation. I know there's a Messianic congregation in Rochester. Come visit the bookstore after service. Oh, buying on Sabbath. Awesome. That's exactly what we should be doing, Nehemiah. What did Nehemiah do when the people were coming to sell their wares on Shabbat? He put guards. He had, no, kill them. Get rid of them. But no, let's open the Judaica shop because, everybody's here for Shabbat. And so, we're selling God's stuff. The largest Messianic congregation in New Jersey. What did they do after the message? Oh, we call it a donation. Somebody's taking money out of their pocket to get a product. To get a product. God, look at verse 2 again. In which are based on a certain hope of eternal life, God, who does not lie, promised that life before the beginning of time. Yeshua said, follow me. Follow me. Yeshua said in Matthew 5:18, what? Not one jot or tittle. So if you want to put up an altar, put up a sacrifice, because God does not change. So if Abraham put up an altar, if Noah put up an altar, if Isaac put up an altar, then you could put up an altar if you do it to proper specifications. God does not change. God does not change. But people say it's too hard to follow. But in Deuteronomy 30, verse 11, God says, for the mitzvah which I'm giving you today is not too hard for you. It's not beyond your reach. We can do it. With God, all things are possible. God, all things are possible. Now let's take a quick look at why we should do what God says, he doesn't change. Turn to 2 Kings. 2 Kings. I'm just giving you a little piece of tomorrow's message. Just a little piece. Something to chew on. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 9 through 13. 2 Kings, verse 18, verse 9 through 13. If God doesn't change, we need to look at the past to see what's going to happen to us in the future when we don't follow God. Once the stink gets up to heaven and God says, I've had enough of this, I'm slow to anger, but now I'm angry. 2 Kings 18, verse 9 through 13. It was the fourth year of King Hizkiyahu, which was the seventh year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, the king of Israel, and Shalmaneser, the king of Ashur, advanced against Shamram, and laid siege to it. At the end of 3 years, they captured it. That is, Shamram was captured in the sixth year of Hizkiyahu, which was the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Israel. The king of Ashur carried Israel away captive to Ashur and settled them in Halak, in Havor, on the Gozan River, and on the cities of the Medes. This happened because they did not heed the voice of their Elohim, of Yehovah their Elohim, but violated his covenant. Everything that Moshe, the servant of Yehovah, had ordered them to do, and would neither hear it nor do it. In the 14th year of the king, Hizkiyahu, Sennacherib, king of Ashur, advanced against all the fortified cities of Yehuda and captured them. Amen? Now, we got to go back a little bit to see what they were doing and see if that parallels what's happening in the world today. Go back to chapter 14 so you can understand what happened in chapter 18, that they got taken away captive. See, when you get taken away captive, you don't have any rights. So women, if 10 men want to rape you, you can't call the police and tell them to stop. You have no rights. They don't want to feed you. They don't want to bathe you. They want to make you sleep on the ground. They want to make you sleep with the animals. You want to sleep or whatever. They want to rape you in the middle of the night, men and women. Then you have no recourse because you're a slave. God gave you over because you didn't want to follow his ways. Now let's see what was going on to have Israel taken away. And does that parallel to our world today? Do we want to follow Barabbas or do we want to follow Yeshua? 1 Kings chapter 14, 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 23 and 24. 1 Kings 14, 1 Kings 14, 23, 24. They erected high places, standing stone and sacred poles on every high hill and under every green tree. Also, there were male and female cult prostitutes in the land attached to these shrines, doing all disgusting things which the nations did that Yehovah expelled ahead of the people of Israel. Amen? Male and female cult prostitutes. Sounds exactly what's going on in the world today, worldwide. The children are being taken, and what are they being used for? Sex slaves. Male and female. So you got this homosexuality going on in 1 Kings, male cult prostitutes. And now that it's risen its head up now and it's becoming more and more bold, the New York City mayor is going against Chick-fil-A because he stands for heterosexual marriage. You got the homos pressing in everywhere. You got a transgender in the Philippines going on that. Bruce Jenner is going to be on the cover of Sports Illustrated naked. This is exactly what's going on. God is slow to anger, but he's about to pop. He does not change. He does not change. So when we see these things, what are we to do? Go back to 2 Kings 18. 2 Kings 18, verse 12. Go back to 2 Kings. What are we going to do? 2 Kings 18, verse 12. This happened because they did not heed the voice of Yehovah their Elohim, but violated his covenant, everything that Moshe, the servant of Yehovah, had ordered them to do, and would neither hear of it nor do it. Amen. 47,000 people were praying in a day of prayer here in the United States of America, or America. 47,000 people, but they don't want to hear what God is saying. God is saying, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, then he would hear from heaven and heal their land. But if we don't, what he's saying here, I'm going to let you get taken. I'm going to let you get, because he doesn't change. He does not change. So if he allowed his own covenant people to be taken out of Israel because they were doing the shrine prostitutes, sexual this, sexual that, teaching the college kids, monogamy is no good. I don't know, my grandparents didn't have all these sexually transmitted diseases. My parents didn't have all these sexually transmitted diseases. I don't have any diseases. I've been with the same woman for 30 years. The only one I took care of that had AIDS, that was married a long time, was a woman in her 90s when I was working in the emergency room. And the reason she got it is because her husband went and slept with a prostitute. But nobody else. How do you get AIDS? How do you get HIV? Intravenous drug use and homosexual sex. Male homosexual sex. It's now being propagated into women too. Look at verse 12. It happened because they did not heed the voice of Yehovah their Elohim. Let's stop there. People don't want to listen. Who do you want? Barabbas or Yeshua, the word of God? We don't want to hear the word of God. We want to choose Barabbas. We want to listen to our leaders. This is the one we want. This is the one we want. We don't want to hear that word of God that makes us, then I can't do what I want to do. Then you make yourself a god. You don't want to heed the voice of Adonai. You want to raise up. Then why was that in the Philippines? Why did that guy get his head cut off? Why? Got an ISIS problem there in the Southern Islands. Why? Because you don't want to heed the word of God. We don't want to heed the word of God here. America, we're going to get smacked. Read Isaiah chapter 1. We're going to get smacked, and we're going to get smacked hard. Because this land was dedicated to God. But how do we stop it? We heed the voice of God. He's calling. He's screaming from heaven. Turn, repent. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, then you know what? I'd hear from heaven. Well, what is the wicked way? Ham sandwiches, Sunday worship. Well, why is it worse now than ever? Well, because we're not teaching anything. 20%, only 20% of people go to church now on Sunday. Well, 20%. Turn to Isaiah chapter 1. We'll do a little piece of it. Last scripture. Hopefully you've learned something. The Lord is screaming. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. One Navy SEAL fought a 400 ISIS. One Navy SEAL who was a Christian. I know I'm hitting hard at the Christians, but there's a true fear. I don't know what's in everybody's heart. God raises up. He was protecting Mosul, where the Christians were. We can do it. Isaiah 1, verse 15 through 17. When you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. No matter how much you pray, I won't be listening because your hands are covered with blood. Wash yourselves clean. Get your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Relieve the oppressed. Defend the orphans. Plead for the widow. Amen. God is saying through his prophet Isaiah here, stop doing evil. Well, what is evil? 613 will tell you what is good and what is evil. Learn to do good. This is what Yeshua meant in Matthew 28. Therefore, make disciples of all nations. Learn to do good. God is speaking from heaven through his word tonight in this Shabbat. He's looking for some soldiers that would stand and be bold and willing to risk it all as Yeshua, our Messiah, gave his all. He left heaven to come be one of us. So when you get to heaven, you can't say, well, you don't know. He does. People were the same back then. Homosexuality, as we've seen in Kings, was already there. Paul writes about in Romans 1. Adultery was there. We see that all over the place. Sin was there. Stealing was there. Everything was there. So we're spreading out our hands, 47,000 people at minimum, 47,000 people, both Jew and Gentile. But God says in Proverbs 28, verse 9, you don't follow Torah, I'm not listening. So he says to his prophet in verse 16, stop doing evil. Learn to do good, then I'll hear you. It's a heart issue, people. It's a willingness to follow the commandments. Yeshua said in Matthew 5, 18, not one jot or tittle. He's looking for a heart that's willing to go and do what is needed. God never changes. So when we see in Isaiah what happened, we see in Malachi what happened, we see in 2 Kings and 1 Kings that we read for this message what happened and why it happened. Since it's happening all around the globe right now, before God allows hell to happen, learn to do good. Because once you're on the train to the camp for the Holocaust, there's no time to repent because you're going to have to go through the spanking. God is calling us from heaven this day because he's raising up disgusting leaders from around the globe. Israel is about to go to war over the Golan Heights, and this will lead to the greatest battle that the world has ever known until Armageddon. So learn to do good before it's too late so that we don't have to go through hell that's on our doorstep. And remember, God never changes.
Shalom, this is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's bethgoyim.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's his loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and he's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you his shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend the day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word, not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.